Hello, Year 10 and 11, and welcome to this lesson on rhythmic devices. Hope everybody is keeping safe and well. Okay, so we come on to our first activity. As usual, we have a do now. Really simply, are these time signatures regular or irregular? So just a quick reminder that regular time signatures are time signatures in which we can split everything up into groups of two or three beats, into even groups of two or three beats, and irregular time signatures don't fit into those even groups. You have 2 minutes to complete this activity. In your books, you need to write down the time signature and then whether it is regular or irregular. Your teacher will press pause on the video now. Okay, so the answers to these four questions. 4-4 is an example of a regular time signature because you can split those into two groups of two beats. 5-4 would be an example of an irregular time signature because it can't be split up into an even group of two or three. It is either a group of three and then a group of two beats or the other way around. 7-8 is another example of an irregular time signature because it needs to be split up into a group of three and two groups of two, or the other way around. And 6-8 is an example of a regular time signature because the beats are split up into two groups of three. Okay, so today's learning objective is to orally recognize the use of rhythmic devices. Now, we've come across melodic devices, and we will be looking at harmonic devices as well. This is something that comes up in our EDUCAST papers an awful lot. Can you please make sure that learning objective is written down and underlined in your exercise books? Your teacher can just press pause if they need to give you a minute to do this. Okay, so you're now going to receive a series of questions about rhythm. These are classic one mark questions that we might get. I say that actually, this first one, it's probably worth more than one mark because it's a rhythmic dictation. So you'd actually get a mark for every correct note value you've got in the right place. So actually this one is worth quite a lot. But these are questions that don't require long written answers. Okay, so I'm going to play this piece of music. You can see that there is a bar missing. All you need to do is you need to write in the correct rhythm of the missing bar. That means you do not need to draw a stave. You do not need to draw a time signature at the start or anything else. You simply just need to draw the note values in your book as you hear them. We don't need the pitch, just the rhythm. So if you think it goes three quavers, a crotchet and a quaver in that order, then that's exactly what you would draw. Okay, you're going to hear it twice. Here it is for the first time. And here it is for a second time. Okay, so the answer to that question was as follows. It was a crotchet, then a quaver, followed by three quavers. So these are two more questions about the rhythm you've just heard. You don't need to hear the track to answer it though, because it's about the time signature at the beginning. Question two and question three. Is this an example of simple or compound time? And question three, is this an example of duple, triple or quadruple time? I'm going to leave this running for 30 seconds while you answer this question. Okay. So the answer would have been for question two, it is compound time because there is an eight at the bottom. So each beat is split up into groups of three quavers. And it is duple time because there are two groups of three quavers. So question two, you should have answered compound, and question three, you should have answered duple. Together, we would call this compound duple time. Okay, this is question four, five, and six. What will happen is I will clap one bar of rhythm. All you need to do is select for each question whether I'm clapping rhythm A, B, or C. So this is question four for the first time. Am I clapping rhythm A, B, or C? I will count to three before I play the bar. One, two, three. And here it is for a second time. This is question four again. One, two, three. Okay, moving on to question five. Is this rhythm A, B, or C? Again, I'll count to three before I start. One, two, three. Here it is for a second time. One, two, three. And finally, moving on to question six, am I clapping rhythm A, B, or C? One, two, three. And for the second time, this is six, am I clapping rhythm A, B, or C? One, two, three. I'll give you 10 seconds to make sure you've got your three answers there. Okay, answers appear on the screen now. Green pen's ready. So, question four was B. Question five was A. Triplet first, then we get two semiquavers and a quaver, and the crotchet at the end. And number six, it was the other way around. The triplet and the semiquaver pattern were the other way around. So that sounded like this. One, two, three. Okay, so we now move on to the fourth part of these rhythm questions. This is question seven, eight, nine, and 10. Really simply, you're going to hear the piece of music and you're only going to hear it once. And you need to tell us if it is in a regular time signature or an irregular time signature. Quick reminder again, regular time signatures fit into even groups of two or three beats. For example, regular time signature would be 4-4, 3-4, 6-8. For example, and irregular time signatures are time signatures that can't be split up into those even groups of two or three beats. For example, 5-4, 7-8, 5-8. I'll say again, you only hear each piece of music once. Here is question seven. Here is question eight.
Try not to get worried, try not to turn on to problems that upset you. Oh, don't you know everything's all right? Yes, everything's fine. And we want you to sleep well tonight.
Okay, now we move on to question nine. And finally, here is question 10. Okay, so the answers to these four questions. The first one was regular, just the two of us with the guitar and saxophone. That was in 4/4. Then the second piece of music you heard from Jesus Christ Superstar was irregular. There were five beats in a bar there. Question nine was also irregular, the Mission Impossible theme tune. And question 10 was an example of regular meter as well in the Hall of the Mountain King. Okay, so this is the final part of your rhythm questions. So there are two parts to this. So in your books, you need to write 11A, B, 12A, B, etc. So what you need to do is this. You're going to, for part A of each question, you're simply going to identify the time signature. So 3/4, 4/4, 6/8, 12/8, 9/8. And for the second part, for B, you're going to describe the meter. So, for example, compound quadruple or compound duple. So you will hear the four clips. Again, you will only hear them once. Here is question 11. Here is question 12. Here is question 13. And finally, question 14. Okay. Okay, so the four answers to these questions. Number one was in 12-8 or compound quadruple. Compound, groups of three, quadruple, four. Four groups of three, 12-8. Number 12 was 3-4 or simple triple. You are listening for that waltz feel that we get in that 3-4 gives us. Number 13 was an example of simple duple. It was in 2-4. And finally, number 14 was an example of 6-8 or compound duple. Okay, so after you've done all 14 questions, please can you go back through and just tally up how many you got right, how well you did. Pop a mark down in green pen. Okay, go through your answers. Make sure you're happy with everything. Anything that you really struggle with, just write down in green pen as a little target for something to work on. You can send that to me via the Google Classroom as soon as you get a chance to this evening. And that will give me opportunity to send you some extra resources to help you out with that if you need. But make a note of where you did well, where you struggled, and we shall move on. Okay, so these are the rhythmic devices we are going to look at today. They're on the board. Some of them you might recognise, some of them you won't. Lots of them are very, very straightforward. There are also some other terms for rhythmic devices that we've covered at other points during our learning. The first one is triplets. And the other one is dotted rhythms, remembering triplets as squeezing three notes into the space of two. So, for example, if my pulse was 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, and I filled that bar with triplet quavers, I would go 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. And dotted rhythms are where you add half the note value to the note. So as you can see in the example, we have a dotted quaver. So a quaver is half a beat. The dot adds half the value on the end. So we have a half plus a quarter, which makes three quarters. You can see there that it's been paired with a semi-quaver, because then together that would make a whole beat. If I played that rhythm of dotted quaver followed by semi-quaver over and over again, it would sound like this. We also very commonly have dotted crotchets and dotted minims as well. Dotted crotchets are worth a beat and a half. Dotted minims are worth three beats. Okay, so we're going to quickly move on to syncopation versus being on the beat. Okay, two definitions there at the bottom. I'm going to ask your teacher to hit pause just while you write those definitions into your book. Off you go. Okay, so we're going to look at this in the opposite way around how it's written at the bottom. Let's start with on the beat. On the beat, a rhythm that mainly coincides with the pulse or beat of the music. So as you can see on the top line of music there, we are in 4-4. It doesn't say at the beginning, but we can work it out, can't we? So we can see four crotchets there. A piece of music that is on the beat, the strong beats will fall mostly on those beats of the bar. We won't have anything that works against that. Whereas syncopation, the rhythms work against those strong beats in the bar. So on the board, what you can see is two rhythms that could be played together. So the top rhythm could act as a pulse. The rhythm below it, okay, would sound like this. Notice the tie between the two quavers that takes that note value across the middle of the bar, remembering that in 4-4 there is an invisible line down the middle of the bar, so we wouldn't just draw that as a crotchet. So again, that second rhythm sounds like this. Quick little class exercise to attempt now. Half of the group, please can you play the top line over and over again like this. Whilst the second group plays the syncopated rhythm underneath. I will count to four to bring the first group in, who will start with that top line. After a few bars, I will count again and bring in the other half of the class to play the bottom line over and over again at the same time. And you will hear what syncopation sounds like. Top line first, ready? One, two, three, four. Keep going with that. One, two, three, four. And stop. Thank you very much. So you can hear how, when we are using syncopated rhythms, we are working against the strong beats of the bar. Syncopation, a rhythm that stresses the weak beats of the bar, or the off beat. So here you can see some examples in different time signatures, strong versus weak beats. So if you have a look, 4-4, let's start with that one to begin with. So of the four beats in the bar, you can see that the first beat and the third beat are strengthened. So that would sound like this. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. The only real exception to that is in reggae music, where the second and fourth beat are strengthened and the first and third beat are slightly weaker. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. In most Western music, though, we see it where the first and third beat are the stronger beat in 4-4. In 3-4, the strongest beat is the first beat of the bar. Strong, weak, weak, strong, weak, weak, strong, weak, weak, strong, weak, weak. In 2-4, the first beat of the bar is strengthened. So it's 1-2, 1-2, strong, weak, strong. In 6-8, the first quaver of each group of three is strengthened. So that would be 1-2. Strong, weak, weak, 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 strong, weak, weak. So, as you can see, this is one of the ways to tell the difference between 3-4 and 6-8. 3-4 and 6-8 have the same number of quavers in them. They both would have six quavers. But because of where the strong beats are, that's what clearly separates them apart. So 3-4, strong, weak, weak, strong, weak, weak. Whereas in 6-8, we get those two strong beats, splitting them up into two groups of three quavers. Strong, weak, weak, strong, weak, weak, strong, weak, weak, strong, weak, weak. It says at the top there, what does this symbol mean? You can see this little arrow, it's like a little greater than symbol above the first crotchet in the music in 4-4. And it appears again on the strong beats throughout the piece. What does this symbol mean? Well, you'll hopefully know that that is an accent. If I go on to the next slide, you can see accents can actually be marked in lots of different ways. Sometimes that little symbol can be vertical. Sometimes it can just be a horizontal line above it. But that's the most common way we represent an accent. And certainly in your set works, certainly for the current year 11, in your set work of since you've been gone, in your annotated score, the accents, particularly the ones that we hear in the pre-chorus, when we change to that E flat major chord on the way into the chorus, we get them marked as accents and they are written like that. Okay, so let's have a look at syncopation. We often associate syncopation with contemporary music. We hear it a lot, particularly in jazz music and lots of popular styles. But syncopation has been used in music for a really, really long time. So this is an example from Beethoven's Eroica Symphony. Can you spot the syncopation? You might be able to spot it now from the music. I'm also going to play it to see if that helps. I will play this extract twice. Thank you. Okay, so hopefully you spotted the syncopation in bar seven from the violin one part. You can see how they are repeated crotchets. You can see how when it goes over the bar line, they're marked as two quavers tied together, or in the second example, a quaver tied to a dotted minim. But you can see how they land on the second quaver of each pair of quavers, which means they are landing on weak beats and it creates syncopation. A couple of extra little questions here, just getting your musical brains thinking. First of all, can you work out what the key signature is? We're in E flat major. There are three flats, B flat, E flat, and A flat. The time signature is 3/4. So how would we describe that meter in words? It would be simple triple time. And then, if you were very simply going to explain the dynamics in this piece of music, we would say that the first two chords, so the dynamics are forte, the first two staccato chords are forte, then piano dynamic for the next four bars. Again, we're being really specific about where we hear this stuff. And then in the last three bars of the extract, it starts piano with a small crescendo throughout the rest of the extract. Fabulous. Okay, so here is another piece of music for you. You're going to hear from the very beginning of this piece of music, but the extract you see on screen is towards the end of the extract. A more popular piece of music this time, but again, can you spot the syncopation? You may be able to see it already. Here it is for a second time. Okay, so hopefully you spotted that towards the end of the extract, you can see it's the third and the fourth bar shown here. Actually, if you look further on, it's also the last two bars as well. We just don't hear that in this excerpt. You can see that you see four quavers played in the third bar, and the final quaver, the fifth quaver, is played at the start of the next bar, which is on the second system. So you can see that there is a quaver rest at the start of the bar, then we hear the first note, a quaver rest, second note, quaver rest, third note, which means that the notes are being played not on the stronger beats, but on the weak beats. So we hear one, two, three, four, one. This is our pulse. One, two, three, four. Is how that rhythm is going to sound. Okay, so moving on now from syncopation, hopefully that makes lots of sense. So we now move on to the next section of rhythmic devices. And I personally think this is the easiest way to get those marks. In those three mark questions that can feel really daunting and really scary, we know that there are some really easy ways to pick up marks. And for that rhythm question, this is definitely one of your three every time. So, in music that has a jazz or a blues feel, so we're talking area of study two here, okay, we're talking about swing rhythms. Okay, we're going to look at these individually in a second as we go through. The next one, when we're describing anything with a strong rhythm, so a really good example would be the Superman theme tune that we used in some of the film music we did recently. Anything with a really strong rhythm that moves the music forward and really gets it going, we can describe that as a driving rhythm. Again, that's a very vague term that can be applied to a lot of things, which again means that if you feel that strong rhythm in that piece of music, driving rhythm is a really good way to go. In dance music, we can simply describe the rhythms as being dance rhythms. We all know what dance music sounds like, and dance rhythms is the simple term we use to describe them. And finally, rock rhythms. And we simply hear rock rhythms in rock music. It really is that straightforward. Please, can you make a note of these in your books for me? Something else to add to your notes is where you're likely to hear these types of rhythms. So as you're writing these down, just make sure you're listening. Swing rhythms is most likely to apply to area of study 2, music for ensemble. Strong rhythms could apply absolutely anywhere, but we particularly hear this in film music, area of study 3, and we will also particularly hear this in popular music, area of study 4. Dance music, you can see, is the third option. You're most likely to hear this in area of study 4, popular music. And the same for rock music, for rock rhythm, sorry, because rock music would come under area of study 4, popular music. Just going to give you 30 seconds to make sure you've got all that down. Fantastic. Okay, so let's look at swing rhythms first of all. What a swing rhythm is it means that it uses swung quavers. So at the start of the piece of music, you will see not the top picture you can see, but the second picture you can see. Okay, you will see that at the beginning of the music. And what that is telling you is that when you see pairs of quavers in this piece of music, you're to play them as swung quavers, which means the first quaver is longer than the second quaver. So if you just look at the picture at the top, where you've got 8 quavers written on that stave there in 4-4, normally we would play that like this. I played it twice for you there, just to show that that is how that would sound, straight quavers in pairs. When we play swung quavers, the first of each pair of quavers is longer than the second. So it would sound like this. 1, 2, 3, 4. Like that. These are used heavily in jazz, blues, and rock. If you want to, the teacher can pause the track there and you can have a go at changing between playing straight quavers and swung quavers. Can you please make sure that that information is written down in your books for me? Your teacher will hit pause to give you opportunity to do that. Okay, so here is an example of swing rhythms. And you can hear, particularly if you look in the second system, we have the quavers at the end of the first bar of the second system and the start of the second bar. You will hear that they're not played. So they should sound dum 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 da dum da da dum. But they don't. Okay, they are played as swung quavers. So the first of each pair is slightly longer and the second one is slightly shorter. Here is the track. Here is the track. There is a 4-bar drum intro before the music appears on here. And the first 4 bars are repeated as piano by the piano before you hear the melody that is played by the saxophone. Okay, so hopefully you heard those swung quavers there on the second system. Okay, you're going to hear it again, but Afterwards, please can you name two other rhythmic devices that you can hear in this piece of music? Here it is again. Okay, so you should have heard, as well as the swung quavers, syncopation and irregular time. Okay, so we move on to driving rhythms or rock music, rock rhythms. Driving rhythms is a rhythm that drives the music, often associated with jazz and rock music, but as we've said, we also often hear it in film music. Rock rhythms, rhythms commonly found within the rock music genre. So here you're going to hear a couple of examples. Here we go. Here's another example. And finally, for this last example, can you tell me if this is an example of a rock rhythm or a driving rhythm? The first two examples were examples of both. Is this an example of a rock rhythm or a driving rhythm? That would be an example of a driving rhythm only, because it was not rock music. It was jazz music, it was Ray Charles. Okay, if you need a bit more time to write everything down, please, your teacher can press the pause button. Okay, so this is Since You've Been Gone by Rainbow. It's one of the set works for the current year 11. And this is the introduction to the piece of music. You're going to hear it once. And you're going to write down all of the rhythmic features that you hear. There are two really key examples in this piece of music, but there are plenty of others as well. So I'm going to play this piece of music twice, and after the second time, I'll go through some ideas with you. Seconds before you hear it again. Here it is for the second time. Okay, so as well as some of the obvious things you're going to point out, like, for example, it's in 4-4, or those classic easy one markers, it's an example of rock rhythms and driving rhythms. There are a couple of other features you could have noted here. So first of all, the use of syncopation. If you look particularly in the third and fourth bar, you can see that the D, the E minor chord at the end of the third bar, and the C chord in the fourth bar are definitely syncopated. So if our pulse is, those chords will sound like this. Dum, 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 da, 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 dum. And we can hear that they're working against the beat. Another rhythmic device here is a change of meter. You can see that in the third to last bar, we change from 4-4 to 2-4. From simple quadruple to simple duple, and then back again to 4-4. Okay, so looking at dance rhythms now, the only thing I need you to get into your books is dance rhythms and the small definition underneath, rhythms associated with different forms of dance. Here are some examples of different dance rhythms that you might hear. And if you hear any of these types of music saying that it uses dance rhythms, it's a perfectly valid answer on an Educast paper for rhythmic devices.
I still hear your voice when you sleep next to me. I still feel your touch in my dream. Forgive me.
Key feature of modern dance rhythms is what was described as four to the floor, which is when you have strong repeated rhythms from the bass drum. So every beat of the bar is marked with a bass drum beat. So normally in rock music, the bass drum would be used on the strong beats 1 and 3. But in dance music, we tend to hear it on every beat. So that was an example of a modern dance rhythm, but here is an example of some world dance or a world dance rhythm. Again, still rhythms associated with different forms of dance, but not necessarily club dance that we are most familiar with in the UK. Again, lots of similar features to modern dance rhythms. You hear those repeated notes that are similar to a bass drum feeling you would get in club dance, but repeated strong rhythms all the way through make it good to dance to. Move on to something very different now. If we look at ballroom dance, things like a waltz or a tango, we hear rhythms again that are very good to dance to because they have a strong pulse that's easy to follow, but it's just presented in a very different way. Again, if you hear a ballroom dance like a waltz or anything like that, a dance rhythm is a perfectly acceptable way to describe the rhythm of that piece of music. That was an example of a waltz, strong dance rhythm in 3-4. Here is another example of a dance rhythm for ballroom dance. An example of a tango, and again you hear the strong pulse that comes through making it good to dance to. There, the use of the snare drum helping to mark that rhythm and show those clear strong dance rhythms. Okay, so We are going to finish today with a quick three-mark rhythm question. Again, we know that a three-mark question, we need three extended bullet points to get those answers. It has to be specific and it has to use musical language. So start with the easy marks. If it is a rock song, you will say that throughout this piece of music, there are rock rhythms or there are driving rhythms. Again, I've said that we hear it all the way through. If you just hear it in the verse or in the chorus, then say that that's only where you hear it. In the chorus, we hear strong rock rhythms, strong driving rhythms. Okay. If you can identify the time signature, name it. But again, you need to be specific. Only if you can guarantee that it stays in that time signature all the way through, should you say it. And if so, this piece of music is in 4-4, or this piece of music is in 3-4. Again, they want full sentences. You could describe the tempo, another easy, easy mark for describing the rhythm. But again, being very careful to make sure you're specific. If the piece of music speeds up or slows down, you can't say this piece of music is fast or this piece of music is slow. You need to say at the beginning, the piece of music is slow, or at the beginning, the piece of music is adagio, using musical language. And in the chorus of the piece, the music is fast, or in the chorus of the second section of the piece, the music is allegro. So you've got to make sure that you are being specific, you are locating, and you're using those key words. Simple sentences, location examples, and key terms. Three easy ways to get marks. Type of rhythm, identify the time signature, describe the tempo. Okay, you can also, though, be looking out for all those devices that we've looked at today. Syncopation, the use of triplets, whether or not it's on the beat most of the way through. Okay, so this is a classic Educast three-mark question. Describe the musical features of this piece, referring specifically to rhythm and meter. I've given you the structure of how to do this. You will hear the piece of music twice. You need three extended bullet points to get the marks for this piece of music. You'll have 30 seconds here. Here it is for a second time. You'll have another 30 seconds here to make sure you've got your answers down. Okay, so looking through the answers, you could have said that there was a 4-4 meter all the way through. you could have said that there was syncopation used by the guitar in the introduction. You could have said that there were rock rhythms all the way through. You could have said that there were triplets used in the drum fill after the chorus. We would have accepted triplets used in the drum fill, or triplets used by the drum after the chorus. You could have spoken about driving rhythms, particularly at the start from the guitar, a fast or allegro tempo, the use of regular meter, and the use of swing rhythms or swung quavers. You needed 3 extended bullet points with location examples, where appropriate, to get those marks. Okay, here is a second question. Now, this one requires, you're going to hear the piece of music 3 times this time. There are 2 separate questions. So we're going back to our work on melody, and the 2 questions are asking you to describe the rhythm and meter for 3 marks and the melody for 2 marks. So these are 2 separate questions that you'll need to separate in your books nice and clearly and neatly labelled. Same approach again to rhythm and meter, thinking about time signatures, devices, those easy marks, rock rhythms, driving rhythms, swing rhythms, etc. Thinking about the tempo, all of those really easy marks in full sentences with location examples. And the same technique for melody, but remembering that when we're talking about melody, we're describing the pitch or the melodic devices or the range, or we're talking, if there's a singer, about the use of melismatic and syllabic. Or we could talk about conjunct or disjunct melody. But same approach. It needs those really good musical sentences with location examples and key terms used. Here is the piece of music for the first time of 3. Thank you. Okay, so looking through the answers to this now, for rhythm and meter, you could have said that there was a 4/4 meter. You could have used the word rubato to describe the tempo, bent or stretch time, or literally meaning robbed time. It takes time away and puts it back in other places. So it's slower in some places and faster in others. It's a key term from tempo to look back over if you didn't get that. You could have used the word largo, adagio, or slow tempo. The fact that there was regular meter, the use of dotted rhythms at the beginning of each, at the beginning of the piece of music. Or you could have referred to the repeated quaver rhythm played by the left hand throughout the piece of music. You could have also said that all the way through this piece of music was on the beat. For melody, you could have said that it was mostly conjunct. You could have said that it was an ornamented or decorated melody. You could have said that it opens with a descending broken chord. You could have said that there was scalic movement. You could have also said that the melody was played at a high pitch, or that it had a small melodic range. Okay, so looking forward to next week as we move on to, sorry, next lesson as we move on to harmony. There are a lot of key terms we've looked at in this work on rhythm and rhythmic devices and meter. Here they all are. They are in your key terms glossary. So you need to make sure that glossary is full with all the correct definitions. Use that as your revision aid to go back through and make sure you are happy with all of these key terms. As always, you can use the Google Classroom to get in contact with me if you need any help or support. So if you can get this work done for me before next lesson, we'll be good to go, ready for me to give you a test at the beginning of next lesson on this. Well done for all your hard work. Work hard at home, and I will see you next time for a lesson on harmony. Thank you very much, and goodbye.